Okay, it is 7:09. Thank you so much. I see all these beautiful faces here. Thank you. Thank you for joining us today for this important tribute. I want to start off by thanking Brian Cena for the wonderful music. Everyone get off mute and let's give it up for Brian or Snap. Woo! 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 Yeah, Brian. DJ Cena. Yes. And I want everybody to take a look at James Haslam in one of these boxes. He brought his family along with him. We are so happy about this tribute today. Hello, family.
Hello.
Hello, family.
Hello.
Hi. Hello. It's good to see you all.
Good to see you too. So today we are honored to be doing this tribute. If you would please let us know in the chat your name, your pronoun, where you're zooming in from, and also if you're a part of any organization, what organization that you're a part of. And I'm going to go ahead and get started with a land acknowledgement, as we do on all our events. So Rights and Democracy acknowledges the Mahican, the Abenaki peoples as the traditional land caretakers of Endicina, which includes parts of Vermont, New Hampshire, New England, and Quebec. As guests on the unceded territory of the Mahican and the Abenaki peoples, we honor their ancestors, elders, and relations past, present, and emerging. We also acknowledge that our nation has benefited from the uncompensated and exploited labor presented in the legacy of slavery and the present-day reality of migrant workers. So again, I want to thank everyone for coming out today to not only give tribute to a special person, but to also honor and celebrate someone who had a vision and successfully carried out this vision based on a theory of change that proved successful and created real people power, not only in Vermont, but also in New Hampshire, with the help of other visionaries like Isaac Grimm. RAD, Rights and Democracy, has proven to be a force to be reckoned with in both Vermont and New Hampshire. And James, you are core to making that happen, so thank you. Though James will be leaving RAD in the capacity of executive director, we are not saying goodbye today. We refuse to say goodbye because we know this is not him leaving us, right? He's never going to leave the movement, right? And so this is more of honoring and celebrating his contributions in this particular aspect of the greater movement. So that's what we're doing today. We are not saying goodbye. We are celebrating his contributions. So I want to start off by just kind of sharing something personal from me. I started working with Rights and Democracy about a year and a half ago. And to be honest, I had a lot to learn. And James was there, he as my supervisor. And people that know me know I can get worked up about certain issues, but he really helped me navigate and helped me figure out how to deal with really hard issues, not only by modeling composure and calm, but also listening, validating, and also showing us to lay everything on the table and to see what's at stake, and then taking a step back and basically always looking at the bigger picture. So that's, I thank you for doing that. Even though that was an important lesson, one of the most important lessons that I've learned from James is actually the need to bring people along with us in order to win. So it's not just about speaking truth into the world, which I personally pride myself in doing, but it's also about getting people to see the truth that we're trying to realize and to bring people along to join with us in order to really win. So I thank you for that. And there's so many other lessons that I've learned from his expertise and his knowledge of organizing that I just don't have time to share with you today because there's so many other speakers. And I also want to acknowledge there are people that also want to honor James that just won't have time to speak today because of the limited time that we have. Also, we want to honor and acknowledge James's family today who are here with us today. Thank you for coming out. Rebecca and Reed and Will, we've seen some of you in our events in pictures. And then I've actually met some of you in real life at some of our events. So welcome. And also it's important to acknowledge that none of our movement would be successful without the love and support of family. And so by honoring James today, in extension, we're also honoring all of you. I also want to give a special thanks to the host committee members who put a lot of work and time and effort into making this event possible today. So I'm just going to really quickly name them. Kathy Elbisa, and I'm going to butcher some of your names, so please forgive me. Kathy Elbisa, Anna Marie Archila, Becca Ballant, Jeffrey Caesar, Celine Colburn, Mary Cordes, Jennifer Epps Addison, Jennifer Flynn Walker, Mary Gannon, George Goal, Jerry Greenfield, Wes Hamilton, Kristen Lane, Kaya Morris, Keisha Ram, Jane Stromberg, Tanya Vahosky, Sandra Yodelman, David Zuckerman, Isaac Grimm, and also special thanks to Franzi Thurman, Mia Schultz, Annie Schwartz, and Maggie Coley for helping make and put all these pieces and make them work so beautifully together today. So thank you so much. We're gonna go ahead and get started. Our first speaker is Nana Turner, who is a former Ohio State Senator and longtime RAD ally. So Nina, take it away.
Thanks so much, and good evening to each and every one of you. It's such a pleasure to join you this evening. I wish I could stay the entire time, but many of you who know me, I just keep going and going and going, and I have two other things after this, but I wanted to really stop by and just lift James up for all of his incredible work. He is indeed a visionary. We have been on many a battlefield together, driving up and down highways and back roads through both Vermont and New Hampshire. He has lended his intellect and his courage to many a project. One in particular that sticks out for me is the social contract project that he had such a vision for, along with some other folks. And it is still extraordinarily important right now to this moment that we have some type of robust social contract with the people who live, work, and play in the United States of America, and by extension, the world. James, you have made rights and democracy a stronger organization, certainly a model to be duplicated all across the country. Your selflessness is unparalleled. I want to give a shout out to your family, because when movement people like you, movement men, movement folks, when movement leaders like you get into the fray, you bring your entire family with you. I am so excited about the next journey that you will be on, continuing to lift this movement, but going into the realm of education to help candidates who are running in that realm, building, continuously using your skills, your gifts, and your abilities to build a stronger, more vibrant nation. That is your calling, baby. That is your vocation, and you do it extraordinarily well. The best is yet to come. I am giving you all of my love and all of my uplift. You are in the mighty tradition of the Mother Joneses of the world. You are in the mighty tradition of the Cesar Chavezes of the world. You are in the mighty tradition of the Fannie Lou Hamers of the world, the Frederick Douglasses of the world. You are in the mighty tradition of the 21st century freedom fighters that are all around us. Many are on this call right now tonight to lift you, and some are other places, not just in this great nation, but all around the world. When everyday people put a little extra on their ordinary, extraordinary things begin to happen, and you are in the realm of creating extraordinary outcomes for people who don't even know that you are doing such a great work. But that is what a selfless leader does. They lead and they do the work and they push and they have courage and they have patience and they have love to do what is necessary in their time to lift both themselves and people in themselves, their contemporaries and generations yet unborn. So James Haslam, you are just getting started, baby. I am giving you all of my love. Congratulations to you, and congratulations to RAD, because you are a stronger organization, because James Haslam was part of a team to make that dream work. God bless each and every one of you.
Thank you so much, Nina, speaking the truth from our hearts. Thank you. And now I'm going to introduce our next speaker, Jerry Greenfield. You've seen him on many ice cream containers. He is a longtime RAD supporter and co-founder of Ben and Jerry's. Jerry?
Thank you. It's great to be here. And who put me on after Senator Nina Turner? I've got to talk to the scheduler about this. SNT. Great to see you, Nina. This is great.
You too, Jerry. Love you.
It's so wonderful to be here, and it's great being on the Zoom call and seeing everybody. I mean, I just can't believe it. Probably like a lot of other people, I've got extreme Zoom fatigue, but just seeing all you guys, I mean, this is like seeing my friends. This is wonderful. And, you know, it kind of reminds me that we're not getting together in person, because I know anytime Ben and I go anywhere, we bring ice cream with us. And that's something that's not happening. But, you know, in a way, and no slight against you, James, but I feel like this is a tribute to everybody. You know, when I look around here and I see the work that everybody is doing, putting yourselves out there, it's really incredible. It's also kind of funny, you know, having a tribute for James. You know, Ben and I, every once in a while, get honored for one thing or another. And, you know, what's been happening recently is we're now getting Lifetime Achievement Awards, because we're over the hill, we're done, and people are just mopping up with us now. So, James, it's nice to know you still have several years left before that starts happening to you. You know, I met James, I think it was probably around 20 years ago. I was on the board of the Peace and Justice Center. James was at the Vermont Workers Center, which at that time was actually connected, a part of the Peace and Justice Center. What you were sort of a young pup at that time, right, James? You were just sort of cutting your teeth on everything. And it's been amazing, not just to see the journey that James has been on, but to be on that journey with him, because he brings us all along. You know, it's kind of funny because, as I've alluded to, I'm a lot older than James, and, you know, people would think Ben and I have a lot more experience. And anytime James would talk to me about some new thing he was thinking of doing or going into, my first reaction was, that's never going to work. What are you thinking? And he always followed through on everything, and he always made it work. And Ben and I have talked about this so many times, how confounded we are about how James does the things he does, because we have no idea. He is clearly the most effective grassroots organizer I have ever come into contact with in all the organizing I've come into contact with, you know, and I get around a lot, and James is in a class by himself. And it's just so wonderful to be here. You know, I started thinking, James leads by having other people lead. That is what is the most amazing thing about him. And you don't even know it's happening sometimes, but that is the magic. So I won't drone on. It's just wonderful to be here and wonderful to see everything. And great to see you and your family, James.
Thank you so much, Jerry. I totally agree. Many a times I didn't have the confidence, but just him having the confidence in me just like brought the confidence out. So thank you so much. Appreciate you. Our next speaker is Ed Taylor, and Ed Taylor is the secretary of our C4 board. He's a board member and also with the ACLU. So Ed.
Thanks so much, Esma. Good evening, everyone. My name is Ed Taylor. I serve as a secretary on the Rights and Democracy C4 Board of Directors, and I am incredibly thrilled to have the opportunity to speak to you all tonight about someone who we all love and cherish, James. I've been on the board of directors for about a year now. In that year, and across a multitude of different projects, I've gotten to know James. James is a dynamic leader, a trusted ally, an innovative thinker, and of course, a cherished friend. I have to be honest with all of you. I didn't think I would be on the board of directors for Rights and Democracy, but after a few calls from my good friend Esma, one thing led to another. I was soon asked by my soon-to-be friend and trusted colleague, Kristen, to serve on the executive committee as the secretary. So I didn't quite know what I was literally diving headfirst into, but I did know the organization had folks on staff who I knew and I trusted. I also knew that this organization fights for people who look and identify like me and shows up for us, come hell or high water. Whenever I see James's name on an incoming email, I know a few things are definitely gonna be true. One, it's gonna be a very long conversation. Two, it's gonna be an incredibly intentional conversation. And finally, it'll be a conversation that will better the future of the mission and vision of this organization. There simply never seems to be enough time. James and I will say, okay, in preparation to end our conversation, but one of us will launch into another topic that we've been meaning to talk about or a topic that we want, you know, the other's thoughts on. And I'm always so happy to see a call coming in from James, but there truly never seems to be enough time. When James told me he was transitioning off, I was incredibly sad because of the short bursts of energy that I was able to get with him. It made me jealous for more. It made me want to have more conversations, have more of these unpacking, you know, hours long conversations about super, you know, specific or broad topics. James has built, of course, in collaboration with a lot of folks on this call, a bi-state organization that centers marginalized and directly impacted people in their advocacy, an organization that helps grow and uplift the voices of those who have been marginalized by society so they can take control of their own destiny. A powerful, powerful organization. There is immense in the mission, the work, the staff, the leaders of this organization, and the best is truly yet to come. And for that, we have to thank James. Thank y'all. And James, much, much love to you.
Thank you so much, Ed, for your beautiful words. Yes, we feel them, and so very true indeed. Our next speaker is Vicky Lampron, and Vicky is a long-term hardcore rad leader. So excited to introduce Vicky. Vicky?
Hi. So thanks for giving me this minute and opportunity to talk a little bit about James. And I've been thinking about James and his role as a leader of RAD and the qualities that he has to fill that position. And I was thinking, what does it take to be a leader and what qualities should they have? A leader possesses a clear vision and sets goals for a group to be successful. A leader is courageous, has integrity, honesty, and humility. Leadership is a verb, and that requires a person to take action, to do something. It's about inspiring others to do things they never thought they could do. So, James, how do you show courage and inspire people? This is best told as a story. I was very new to the grassroots scene, so new, in fact, that the first time I heard James use the word grassroots, I had to look it up in the dictionary to see what it meant and to figure out how grassroots organizations are structured. I believe it was 2016 that a group of RAD folks went to Washington, D.C., my very first time, to a conference put on by People's Action. I was so excited to be included. At that time, Bernie was on the campaign trail to get the nomination, and he would be speaking at the conference. I was going to hear Bernie speak in person. James said to me very calmly, kind of with that little side smirk he's got, "Hey, you know, Bernie's speaking at this conference. Would you like to introduce him?" James showed great courage in asking me to do this. I thought many times on the way to DC that I was a big faker, and who did I think I was? I just knew I was going to embarrass myself in the organization, but guess what? I succeeded. You see, a great leader raises people up. A great leader inspires others to believe in themselves. And James did that for me. I will be forever grateful to you, James, as that act of courage on your part made me believe that I could do what I originally thought was impossible. Thank you, James, and I just love you.
Thank you so much. Those are clearly tears coming from the heart. And I can see that James is clearly feeling it too. Family's feeling it. Thank you for your honesty. Thank you for sharing. Yes, and remember, he's not leaving. We're gonna continue organizing with him in another capacity. So don't worry, he's still in Vermont. We're still gonna organize with James for sure, for sure. Okay, so is Jeffrey Caesar on the call? Is there Jeffrey, is he here?
I don't see him on here.
Oh, okay.
So I think, yeah, I'll shoot him a text and see if there's he can jump back in, but yeah.
All right, so maybe this is a good time for our musical performance with some entertainment to lift our spirits up, because I wanna remind everybody, we're celebrating here. We're celebrating and we're gonna continue working and organizing with James. And so I'd like to introduce Griffin Sinclair Wingate. And Griffin is actually on our board, but he also has a talent. So Griffin, what are you gonna entertain us with today? Some music?
I'm gonna be juggling. I hope everyone's excited to watch me juggle some ball. No, I'm gonna be playing guitar. And can y'all hear me all right? It's a good level. I'm using this crazy mic. I don't normally use it with Zoom. Does it sound good?
Yep.
Yeah, all right, cool. All right, I'm gonna play a tune that I wrote recently. And it's a tune about the climate crisis. It's such a lame intro, but I'm gonna just roll with it.
There are ashes in the eastern skies, in towns and homes, and people's lives in the west. Where the fires blaze, but the skyline's beautiful in that haze. And the mountains look like silhouettes in the smoky sky when the sun starts to set. It's not how I'm I would see this for once crisis come to be.
on, get off mute. Get off mute. We need to hear Griffin, we did not know about this talent.
Thanks, Griffin.
Thank you so much.
Do one more, Ozma? Is that all right?
Yes, absolutely.
Awesome, cool. This is another tune that I'll keep it, my remarks about James, really brief, because y'all have a lot of speakers tonight, and I was told to play music, not to speak. But damn, James, like you, like probably everyone on this call came into my life and shot it in a totally different direction. I am just this month finishing up my my final term as a RAD board member, because I'm terming out. I've been here 4 years. That is absolutely shocking to think about. And it's really cool to think about everything that we've accomplished in that time. So thank you so much for your leadership and guidance. And I'll just leave it at that. And I'll play this tune for y'all.
Start to rise, and the beach homes get swallowed in the rising tide. Not with us to our newly found lives, off to the urban ruins with their suits and their ties. Time spent working for fame and fortune, we should have been enjoying lives that we could have been loved, could have had fun, and it could have been something, but it's nothing now. Where will we go when we stop to realize that the world is burning down right before our eyes? When we stop lead to riots, and the riots lead to war, and the schools shut down, and the hospitals close the doors. Well, I don't think it'll matter anymore. Anything and everything that we cared about before. Time spent working. Fame and fortune, we should have been enjoying lives that we could have been loving, could have had fun, and it could have been something, but it's nothing now. Come fool and fighters need your open eyes. Come doctors and come farmers, need you to survive. Come saints, come sinners, you're equal in
so much for listening, y'all. Thank you so much, James, for everything you've done. and all the work you've done to prevent the tragedies in those songs from occurring. So much hope in rights and democracy and in the movement that you're still a part of. I think when people leave and go to different places in the movement, it feels less like they're leaving an institution or an organization and more like they're just like transferring to a different department of the movement. So thank you so much, James, and back to you, Haslam.
Yes, thank you for that reminder. And Griffin, wow, like we need to like actually use you in other spaces too. We didn't know you could sing like that. Okay. So that's just for you, James. He's brought it just for you in the family. Thank you so much. And now I'd like to introduce Isaac Grimm, who is Rad's longest employee and who's actually worked with James even before Rights and Democracy and is a visionary in his own right. And he's helped build Rights and Democracy up in New Hampshire. So Isaac.
Thanks, Isma. Thanks, everybody. All right, y'all, time for me to air 6 years of grievances and complaints about working with James. Here we go. No, I'm just kidding. It's been amazing. So it's kind of hard to put in words what James has meant to me in my life. For those who don't know, I've known James for a very long time. I first got to know him when I was a young student activist at the University of Vermont. Really new to having even anything you could call like political awareness. And in his role with the Vermont Workers Center at the time, they were supporting young student activists and on-campus campaigns and bringing young activists into the movement. And I'm so grateful for that because it really set me on a journey that I could have had no idea that, you know, 15, 20 years later, it would take me to where I'm at now. And I will always be so grateful to that. Through that connection, James helped bring me down to the first US Social Forum in 2007 in Atlanta, Georgia, which was an incredibly inspiring and really important formative experience for me. And while I did graduate and move away for a number of years, I stayed a Worker Center member through that entire time and looked on in awe and inspiration as I was living outside of the country and saw what the Worker Center under James's leadership was doing, which was making national waves and helping pass, you know, really bold and like nothing else was happening in the country like a universal single payer healthcare bill on a state level. And so I always stayed in touch. And when I moved back and reconnected with James, I was working as a union organizer, and that brought me back to Burlington, Vermont to support some adjunct campaigns there. And after a year of that, it was sort of time to figure out the next thing to do. And I was living long distance from my partner and trying to decide what to do. And the easiest and kind of safest thing, right, would have been to get a job that brought me to Portland, Maine, where she was living. And instead, James talked me into, as James is so good at doing, talked me into taking this leap of faith, staying long distance. And that was not an easy decision for me. And taking on a role with an organization that didn't really exist yet. It was just an idea, right? It was just like this beautiful vision that James had. And I'm so glad that I did. And it's been really hard work. There have been times where it's been exhausting and anxiety provoking. And I don't think anyone else could have like gotten me through all that in the way that James has. And what I will always just really appreciate and treasure is, like other people have said here, like the trust that James put in me and the belief he had in me and my leadership. He saw what I could become before I could. And it's because of that that I've been able to grow into who I am now in this organization. It's the connections that it's brought to me, the opportunities that he's brought, all the amazing people on this call and that we are all connected to. I'm just so incredibly grateful to James for believing in me, to being my mentor, and helping guide me through the many, many twists and turns that we've had building rights and democracy from this small thing that it was in the beginning, but it was already, like, James already had where we are now in his mind, and it was just sheer force of will to get there. And, you know, the ability to bring others along into believing that vision together, right? So I just will always be so grateful to James for all of this. And, you know, I'll forgive you for stealing my thunder. I'm leaving as well. And James, you know, had to go ahead and announce at the same time. And now it's this whole celebration for James. No, like James and I will always stay connected, and I will always stay connected with rights and democracy. This has been my political home, and just an absolute treasure of a community with all of y'all. And we will always both stay cheerleaders and stay leaders and supporters for the movement for rights and democracy. And yeah, I don't know what else to say beyond that. Just thank you, James. Love you so much.
Thank you so much, Isaac. Thank you. Yes, everybody knows you're also leaving. Thank God you're not leaving soon. So we still have you for another at least 7-8 more months, right? So yes, but yes, thank you so much for your words, and very, very true, very true. Thank you. And now I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Allison Neihart, who is a former RAD board chair and also a member leader. So Allison.
Hey, James. I started to write some remarks for you, and they just wanted to be a poem. So I have a poem for you tonight. James, you once asked me to step into a role I had no confidence I could fill. I didn't understand why you would ask me. You once asked me to speak at an event I thought I had no business speaking at. Wasn't there someone else, I wondered? Your faith that people like me, can affect our future is alluring. We need you, you said. You matter, you said. And you said it in a way that I could actually believe it myself. And so I picked up the clipboard, I knocked on the doors, and I started to feel that sense that maybe you were right, that I could, that we would. Then I started to understand why you asked me, because that idea that what we do matters also has a dark side. If we truly believe it, it becomes a burden, because what we do, what we don't do, every decision, every action, every inaction feels weighty. And holding that weight can feel lonely. You asked me because not enough people believe. Not enough people know their power. Not enough people are doing a little so that some people don't have to do a lot. Your vision requires those who might stay in the shadows to understand their power and to take their place in the sun. Once we do, we look around. We see others emerging, but not nearly enough. And we start to wonder who else is waiting for someone to ask them. The irony of doing the work of building power is that doing the work isn't the most important part. In fact, doing the work is not nearly as important as asking others to do the work. You understand the need to grow leaders who grow leaders who grow leaders who work together to change the world. This is just one of the legacies you leave with us at RAD as you turn a corner onto your next path. You leave ripples of believing in the power of inviting more people to join us, the ripples of believing that when you ask someone to do something they aren't sure they can do, that asking them is the thing that helps them imagine they can do it. Ripples that move out and out so far that we may never know their source, was a conversation you had when you asked someone to believe in themselves. Thank you, James. Love you. Good luck.
Allison, that was so incredibly beautiful. Yes, you could see the whole family clapping there. That is so true, so true. Asking and believing in us. I know some people who ask and don't believe, but they just ask. No, James actually believes that people can do it. So thanks so much. Yes. And now we're going to hear from Vermont State Senator Keisha Ram, who couldn't be here, but she insisted on making sure that she was one of the speakers today. And so she wound up recording something and asked if we can share. So that's fine. We can do that. And she recorded something, and we're going to have one of our awesome comms people, Maggie, share her recording. So this is Senator Keisha Ram of Vermont.
Hey, everybody. Hey, James. For those of you who may not know me, I'm Senator Keisha Ram Hinsdale, and it's an honor to join you for this special and important occasion. I really want to thank Fonzie, Asma, Kaya, all of the great folks at Rights and Democracy who helped make this a special tribute. I also know that Sister Nina Turner is there celebrating as well, and so much love and support and just strength to you, Sister Nina. It is just an honor to be part of this celebration and to think about James's contributions. Really, I'm just reflecting on when Rights and Democracy started. I remember at the time thinking, that's a really powerful and important name for an organization. And now, several years later, I can't think of anything more important for us to be focused on than our rights and our democracy. So kudo to James and the leadership at RAD for having that vision and executing it so powerfully, meaningfully, and beautifully. And the work is not over, the fight is far from over. And we know that James is, you know, not leaving the fight, but opening a different chapter and making space for other leaders to rise. And I can't think of anything more powerful to crown, you know, James's incredible contributions through the Worker Center and through RAD. You know, I'm reflecting back, I think James was still at the Worker Center before RAD had come into being, when I was sort of complaining or upset about something that felt unfair at a forum. And James looked at me with that classic kind of stony look and said, "You're an elected official and you're held to a higher standard." And I've just never forgotten those words. It helps me get up every day and keep fighting late into the evening and, you know, standing tall, knowing that I am held to a higher standard. And while that sometimes feels unfair, I chose this work. We all have chosen to be in a fight for our imperiled rights, our imperiled democracy, for those who don't feel that they have access to the same rights, for those who don't feel the benefits of a representative democracy, for those who are disenfranchised. And that means that we hold ourselves to a higher standard and allow others to do the same. James has done that for a long time. He deserves a break. But not without an incredible celebration and going out from this work with a bang, getting to spend time with his awesome wife and his awesome kids, and joining us again in the fight. So I hope you're enjoying your send-off, James. I know it's hard for you to be celebrated in this way, but you deserve it. And I can't wait to keep working with RAD to fight for racial, social, economic, and environmental justice for all. Thank you.
Awesome, awesome. Yes. So we want to thank Senator Keisha Ram. Yes, family's happy. Look at the family, they got their RAD shirts on too. That's great. Yeah, thank you, Keisha Ram. And now we have a performance. And so Last October 17th, we had an event on the New Hampshire side, something similar to this, to acknowledge and recognize Isaac Grimm. And within that event, we had a talent show and also karaoke. And what we discovered is one of James's hidden talents was spoken word once upon a time. And so we've asked him if he would share with us some past poems that he's written, and he's agreed to do that. So without further ado, James.
Oh my, this is this is a lot, and incredibly powerful to see all your faces and to be here and to thinking about what we're doing with this movement. When I agreed to do this, I wasn't anticipating being as emotional as I am right now, full disclosure. It's funny, the poem I'll share is one that I actually wrote almost exactly 19 years ago. So it's interesting, you know, especially hearing some of these stories, some of you, you know, I actually knew 19 years ago. And just thinking about the poem, getting ready for tonight, the words, think about, you know, that person, that young organizer 19 years ago, what we've done together, what that young 19 years ago person would have thought about what, you know, what we've accomplished. And it's also pretty funny how much I've changed since then. Just also thinking about the lyrics in the poem, I had the time. These are glasses to see close, but I used to have glasses to see far. But I had corrective eye surgery that is referenced. We've had a home for a while, but I was a renter at the time. You know, a bunch of things changed. Some people might remember I used to be pretty clean shaven all the time. That was also referenced.
I remember. Yeah.
But anyway, it was actually, I wrote back in the day when I was writing some of these poems, it was partly because I was super bored driving around Vermont. We didn't have smartphones back then really. And so, and, you know, a lot of places, there's not great radio stations. You can't call people, cell phone coverage was terrible. So sometimes I would make up these rhymes. And 19 years ago, it was actually a pretty tough year for me. It was the year my mom died. And so I was in kind of like a dark place. And so I was trying to like make up a poem or a rhyme that, you know, it's like kind of bringing me into a better spot, getting myself in a better feeling good. And so it's a little silly. In all good fun, I will share it. I will share it now. I called it me, and I'll share it. It's pretty quick. I'm an inventor, a mentor, apartment renter, a dissenter. Where it says exit, I enter. I'm a BMW denter. I'm a venter, I'm a ranter, I'm a raver. Sometimes I can be a pretty bad behavior. About every 3 days, I'm a real close shaver. I ain't sugar, but I got some pretty sweet flavor. I don't believe in any soul saver. But to change this unjust system, I will stand with you. I will fight with you. I won't waver. Together we'll be path pavers, trail blazers, ruling class crazers, and historian amazers. Right now, I'm just trying to save up so I can go under the laser and become a better stargazer. But even though I'm a spectacle wearer, it doesn't stop me from being a beautiful people stare. Like cops don't stop me from being a parking ticket tear. Like this greedy system doesn't stop me from being a personal possession share. I don't want their fame. I just want to be free. I don't want to play their game. I just want to be me.
Everybody get off mute. Get off mute. I want to hear it.
Yes. Yes.
Amazing. Amazing. So many hidden talents. I love it. Path pavers, trailblazers. Like, who predicted this is what you would be doing in the future, inspiring others to do? So awesome. Yes, can I also add one? Can we also be like rad organizing amazers to the poem? All right, thank you so much, James. Absolutely. Yes, thank you. And now we're going to hear from Kathy Albisa. And Kathy is with the RDI board, and she is also vice president of Race Forward. So without further ado, Kathy.
Well, I'd like to just first confess that I made a decision not to prepare these remarks, which is really not like me. But there were three reasons. One was Nina Turner was opening up, so what was the point? The second was James was performing right before I was talking. And the third is, although it seems counterintuitive, I have so much respect and regard and actual real human affection for James that it seemed like performing wasn't the right thing to do. So I just decided I would share whatever came to mind. Which most people don't get that, James. So as I was sitting here listening, I decided that our relationship was characterized by the question, why not? And most people who do know me here know that I met James also through the Healthcare as a Human Right campaign when he was at the Vermont Workers Center. And we had been where I was at an organization called Nesri looking for a group to partner with for 3 years. But couldn't find any groups who actually understood what the word universal was and were demanding that everyone be included. So we heard about this worker center in Vermont, a worker center running a universal healthcare campaign, which was my first why not in relation to James. Well, why not? Let's find out what they're doing. And it turned out they were the only group we could find at that point in time many years ago that were demanding that everyone, including undocumented immigrants, be included in the system. And we worked deeply together. We came really close. And more importantly, James's vision and effort changed the terrain. And now it is part of all our movement's asks that we've learned what the meaning of universal was through that effort that he led, he designed, he thought about all those years ago. And that mark is still making waves today. After that, he told me he wanted to start Rights and Democracy. And I said, so you're gonna start an organization in two states that are politically kind of different to do something you've never done before. You're gonna work on all the issues and you're gonna build electoral power. And so I thought, well, it's James, why not? And of course, he did. Why not? He doesn't ask, he doesn't look for obstacles. He just says, why not? If he knows it's right, he says, why not? So then I got my turn to get him to say, why not? And I asked him, I said, hey, we're doing this new social contract project because we think we just need to put out this big ask that we look at the history of race in the United States, except that we've screwed everything up in terms of how we design our systems because of it. And that we should reboot in a completely different approach, looking at income solidarity, a risk solidarity, and sort of community level democracy, and weave it together into this whole new idea. And we're gonna call it the new social contract. And he said, why not? And not only did he say, why not? He says, I'm gonna up you one on that. I'm gonna raise you one. You're gonna do, because that's the problem with James. If you talk to him, he gives you an assignment. You're gonna do a new social contract on workers. And the next thing I know, he's organized like the five major worker rights networks in the country to get behind this report. And Bernie Sanders is waving it one day saying, this is what we need. And in fact, many of those ideas that he pushed into that report are alive and moving today. Why not? And now I'm at 4 minutes, but I'm gonna say two more, if you can forgive me for that, Asma, because I didn't time myself. The next one was you, Asma. For some bizarre reason, James didn't have enough people to honor 1 year, and he asked me to come and be honored. And I showed up and I watched Asma present. And I turned to James and I said, you need to hire her. Apparently he said, why not? And then the last one was most recently. There was a nefarious bill, as many people here know, in New Hampshire, that took the position that talking about racism is racist, that there is no systemic racism, and that in fact, talking about racism hurts white people. That is the fundamental kind of premise of that bill. And get this, James, my white guy, he's my white guy from Vermont, calls me at Race Forward and was the first one to alert me to this happening. And we discovered that it was happening in dozens of states across the country. So I got back to him and I said, James, this is the new terrain that our opposition is coming after us on. And he said, well, why don't we come up with a national strategy to turn it on its head and turn it into an opportunity and talk about why we need a whole different approach to education as the foundation of changing our democracy and actually using it as a moment to ask for what we want. To which I had to say at this point, because I'd given up on questioning, why not? And so now you're gonna hear from him about what he's done, where he's going, and how he continues to change our country and influence the world, I do believe, because we live in a very interconnected world by his vision and his goofy optimism that always lands in why not. Let's just go ahead and do it. So I'm going to hand it over to James, and thank you, Asma, for having me.
Thank you so much. But no, James, not yet. because I'm going to introduce Mia Schultz. Mia Schultz is a RAD staff who is leading our Catalyst program and doing so much on the Vermont side. So I would like to introduce Mia.
Thank you, Esma. Thank you. I mean, I'm one of the most recent hires here at Rights and Democracy as a Catalyst leadership organizer and all kinds of other things. And I just, listening to everybody here is like, there's a theme. And I happen to be need to be added to that list of people that James saw something in, even when we didn't see it ourselves. And so here we are. James, the staff have sent you a little gift. You have it over there. You got the gift. We want to present you with that gift. And there's a theme that you might love.
We're going to get it.
Okay. And so we have a theme on that. So we'll just wait for you to get the gift so you can open it up, and then we'll share on the screen as well what you're getting. He's excited. All right. So Maggie is gonna share the screen as well, so we can see also, the audience can see what you got. And let's see what we got. Go ahead.
Okay.
Whoa. Is that a theme you can relate to, Maggie? Oh, can you show everybody?
Episode one, Rise of the Movement.
Okay. Maggie, so... can you tell us, man. Tell everybody, nice. All about this gift.
Oh, I like how, like, in all of this, there's just like an Ewok. Oh,
Maggie.
Oh, yeah, so Will and Reed, do you see that little character between you two?
Yeah.
This is amazing.
And the lightsabers. Yeah, we thought you'd appreciate that.
Rise of the Movement.
R2.
This is episode one. I guess there's many more episodes. I'm not a big follower, like, you know. But I think this is amazing. We've got our employees, current employees. We've got our partners. We've got board members.
Oh my goodness.
Everybody's there that we could think of there for you.
Thank you so much. This is amazing. Thank you so much.
Thank you, James, for everything.
Thank you, Mia. I can't wait to just continue to watch your leadership grow. And yes, we are, as you can see here, we are a huge Star Wars family.
This is actually my dad's helmet.
It's so great. Thank you.
Awesome, awesome. I'm so glad you like the gift. And you are supposed to speak now, but there is someone that really wants to speak. And I think we should just like allow this person. And then I promise you'll go right after. We're not going to allow anyone else to speak. If anybody wants the same thing, email him. He will appreciate it, I'm sure. I'm so sorry. I know so many people want to honor you today. We just don't have the time. Just one last person. Mary Cordes, who is one of RAD's founding leaders in Vermont and is one of our most fearless elected movement champions. So, Mary.
Thank you, Asma and James. I just want to start out, I love you. And like my tattoo means rebellions are built on hope. And so many times you have, even when it was hard for any of us to feel hope, especially I'm thinking of the 2016 elections in November and not getting much sleep and doing a lot of crying and gnashing of teeth, waking up the next morning and saying, okay, that's enough of that. What are we going to do next? And I think you were the first person I called and met you and Isaac and Jessica. Hi, Jessica. Hi, Isaac. I've missed you too. And we had pho and sat around and talked about the next steps of our rebellion, our revolution. And James, you have introduced me to so many people in this beautiful family, including Asma and Mia and so many of you out there. Hello and big love to all of you. James, thank you for helping our nurses union get started. I was a founding member and you were there all the while helping us grow, and we're still growing. You and I had a fork in the road about the same period of time when I left union leadership and you were leaving the Vermont Workers Center. And we both had our own tears about that, but moved on. You helped me get elected. You and James, I mean, you and Isaac, in my first primary, I couldn't get the results from all the towns. It was you and Isaac that called me to tell me that I had won. You sent me the most amazing organizers. Hi, David, I love you. Jessica Early, Allison Neihart, just amazing campaign leaders. And got me connected to the Healthcare as a Human Right campaign. There's just so much. There's so much. And it's hard for me to imagine you not being part of RAD. You'll always be part of RAD, but moving on. But I'm so glad you're still in the movement. Again, I love you. And thank you. Thank you for everything.
Thank you, Mari.
Thank you. Thank you. And now we are ready to hear from the man himself. yeah. Take it away, James.
Oh, thank you so much, Esma. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Mari. I see so many people on the Zoom that I would love to be able to talk with. Mari and I go way back. Mari, as you just said, yeah, back on the nurses, organizing campaign when they were trying to organize their union after many struggles back in like 2002. So also close to 20 years ago, about the time when I was writing that poem. And also Mari, it was like
the early conversations for building rights and democracy, when it was just a early stages, Mari was one of the first people. Mari, Kaya, you know, there's a handful of people to talk about, you know, what we were trying to build. And it's been just so amazing to see, Mari, your leadership grow and so many people's leadership grow. You know, as has been said, I am transitioning from this role, but we are staying here in Vermont, and we are excited to continue to support Right to Democracy and do whatever we can to help continue it flourishing and thriving. With a new project, when I made the announcement back in May, I was like, Right to Democracy has leadership, stronger leadership, stronger staff than we've ever had. And, you know, we've been through a lot. I was ready for a new challenge. Being an organizer is awesome. Being an ED is not the best thing in the world all the time, of like an executive director that has to deal with a lot of the back end of the organization. And I was ready to pass the baton, get some new energy, help find someone that could help take it to the next level. But I didn't know exactly what I was going to do. As Kathy mentioned, I was trying to figure out, what my role could be in helping deal with the problem of what's happening in our country right now, where increasingly it's being polarized through these culture wars and torn apart, and just seeing it happen in our community here in Essex, where one of the most progressive school board members that we had lost to an anti-BLM activist this past March on these kind of issues. Just looking at the news every day, you know, made me very concerned. So I'm super excited to be able to continue to work with Rights and Democracy in a different way, that since Rights and Democracy is doing education justice organizing in both Vermont and New Hampshire, to try to unite communities, to bring people together when there are forces trying to pull us apart. So we're getting ready to publicly launch. So the thing that I'll be doing next, on a national level, but Right to Democracy is already doing, is a project called Heal Together, Honest Education, Action, and Leadership, that is a project that is going to be focused on trying to have a school district level organizing model to help parents and high school students and educators organize together. So working with the teachers union, working with groups like Rights and Democracy and others, working with student groups. In Essex, there's a great group called the Social Justice Union, but working on a school district level to build infrastructure to advance education justice, to advance high quality public education as a building block for thriving communities and for a multiracial democracy. And so I'm super excited that Rights and Democracy is already doing this work. In fact, the first Heal Together official event happened last night in New Hampshire, at Esma, and Kevin and Dana and crew were leading over there. Me and Mia were over there sitting in from Vermont. But we're excited. We'll probably have a national launch in early 2022 around this project. And so I'm excited, even though I'm transitioning out of this role, that we'll be able to continue to work together on that. And I'm going to be working with Kathy over at Race Forward with a whole bunch of other national partner organizations like People's Action, Working Families Party, Local Progress, and others. One of the big parts of the strategy will be trying to have movement candidate, you know, many, many more movement candidates running for school board. And it's happening now, and we're just going to be trying to build on that. You know, just last week, Rights and Democracy champions got elected in New Hampshire for a school board on, you know, that have been working on these issues. There's big elections happening on school board in both states coming up in 2022. We'll be working with folks around the country to try to do as much work as we can on that to unite our communities. So just excited. If anyone's interested, feel free to reach out. Happy to talk more about it. But just excited that I'll be able to get to work, continue to work with Rights and Democracy moving forward. And just appreciate you all. You know, there's a lot of powerful people in this Zoom that I'm counting on to help continue building this organization. We think of it as grassroots, people-powered infrastructure that needs to be durable enough that, as Allison so incredibly beautifully put, you know, that where leaders find leaders that find leaders that find leaders, so we can realize the vision that we're fighting for and our communities can live up to the values that we share. Thank you so much. I also thank everyone who contributed for this. We didn't know exactly how much we were going to be able to raise with this fundraiser. I've been blown away with how much, how many people donated and everything. So I just really appreciate that. We're going to continue to raise money so we can get this organization thriving into the future. So I appreciate that very much.
Thank you so much, James. We wish you the best for you, your family, for the movement. And thank you for your vision, your leadership, and knowing when to pass on the baton, when literally, you know, like we're doing our best right now and just trusting that the best is yet to come for the organization that you literally birthed. So we can't close off without final words from one of the most amazing leaders that we have in Rights and Democracy. So Kaya Morris is the Movement Politics Director of Rights and Democracy on the Vermont side, and she is going to give the last words.
What an honor, y'all. This is so beautiful and so gorgeous. So, if you don't know my history with Rights and Democracy, let me just say that I first came to know James back when he was still with the Worker Center. And we went through that whole first term of me finding my voice and stepping into my voice. And one of the things that I felt actually made me very effective on some levels in being able to serve effectively and govern effectively was that I wasn't really starstruck. I didn't really understand the conventions of how you are or are not supposed to function within state government. And I just came with an unapologetic voice and a recognition that the people who voted me in wanted me there. And they wanted me for that unapologetic voice. But that was a really hard-fought battle for me to get in the first time around. And I remember feeling so disheartened because I came in and I ran as a Democrat and assuming that the Democratic Party was gonna be there to come and help buoy me through this, and in many ways was not only absent, but some ways were counter to what I needed to do. And so it come time for my next reelection. And I sit down at this table in Bennington at this coffee shop there with James, and he says, you know, we're starting this organization. And what we basically need to do is we need to make like 100 versions of you, okay? So we need to stack up our state government with people who are willing to step into their voices and will hold that political courage and will have the ability to really represent the needs of our people. And it was so loving. In a space where you're always doubting whether or not you can be there, you're feeling threatened even in small ways. Now this is way before like the drama threats that, that everybody knows that are associated with my life had even begun, right? But this was this like trajectory of thinking like, what is this gonna mean for me to do this? Everything that it takes that you have to sacrifice in order to serve an elected office, whether or not it was gonna be worth it. And James said, yes. It is worth it, and we're going to help support you so that you can be able to stand in that and know that you are where you're meant to be. And then we got Trump. And I'm just saying this to say what he started with, this little plucky idea, right? And the super small team. I mean, you had like Isaac and Shay and Kate, and like, you know, you had folks that were doing like 12 people's jobs like all at once, like all of these two dozen people that we have now within Rights and Democracy was like a small crew that you could count almost on one hand. And they were so, so bold in their vision and their dreams and in the real heart of like trying to create grassroots organization. that we had folks in our community, and one of the least politically active communities in the ways that we would imagine it to be, where you don't see big protests, you don't see folks showing up, except for sometimes the wrong reasons, right? Where he was able to take and build out that vision and have amazing people like Vicky, who may not have seen themselves as being that activist or that politically engaged person, who were going out and getting arrested, protesting Trump 4, 5, 6, 7 times without hesitation. And it was something to brag about. And I would on the national stage to say, you know what? If there's a protest happening against Trump and 100 people get arrested, about 10 to 12 of those came from Vermont and they were all organized by Rights and Democracy. And by the way, a chunk of them folks came from my constituency. And that had everything to do with the vision that James had and the passion he brought and the people he brought in who said, we see these communities that are not being touched and we need to touch them. And James stayed with me through this whole time of me like hemming and hawing about what is this future going to mean for me. And in the final moments before I even became on staff, where I had a conversation with him and said, I don't even know if I'm going to stay in the state. After everything my family has been through, after everything we've experienced, is it worth it for me to continue giving to Vermont? Is it worth it for my mom to worry about me being here when she's been begging me to leave for years? I don't know why I'm here. And he said, there is a place for you at RAD. How can we take your vision and your dreams and make that happen? You want to do the work of your heart. How can we get really freaking busy to make that happen? And that's what James has been doing for all these years, is busy, busy trying to make people's life's work happen. And this is what it has birthed, and it only continues to grow. And so I am so honored to have you as a friend, and so honored to have been a part of this journey, and so grateful to see all of the folks that you have brought along the way when they said it couldn't be done, when they wanted to just dismiss it, and you're like, whatever, watch me move. Thank you so much for everything, James. Thank each of you for being a part of this and for supporting James through this. We gotta thank Rebecca for like, not getting mad at all of us and cussing us out on a daily basis because she's kind of been missing part of her family for the last several years. And thank you to your children for constantly giving you the love and filling your cup back up in the ways that you needed when we are absolutely being battered. Thank you so much. And thank you for giving me the chance to say goodbye. But I'm not saying goodbye yet, but just tonight. So thank you all so much. Thank you for supporting Rights and Democracy. The best is absolutely yet to come. And I expect to see each and every one of you a part of that.
Thank you so much, Kaya. Thank you, everybody. It's really, really beautiful and touching. I'm obviously inspired by all of you. And, it's weird for me to feel like in the focus of a night like tonight, but it's beautiful to see all of your faces, because this is something we built together, and we still have a lot of work to do, but I know we can do it, because you're all powerful.
Can we get everybody to come off mute and just like,
yeah, shoot. I'm ready to get off mute.
Woo!
Thank you so much, James. I don't know who's crying. I'm not crying.
You are.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you. I hope you're having a special night.
Bye, everyone.
See you later.
Bye, everybody.
Travin.
Thank you, James.
Talk soon.
Hey, Nicole.
Oh,
Hi. Hi.